Hey guys, what's going on? Welcome to the first episode of Reformed Reacts. I'm Jake. Some of you know me as Jake Plays Bass, and I'm joined with my good friend Jack here. How's it going, Jack?
I'm doing fine.
Yeah. How about you? So, today we're going to be looking at some Christian heavy metal. a little bit, it's a very familiar area with me. I don't know about you. I'm guessing you...
Metal's not my favorite, but yeah. I'm willing to sit here and listen to anything that you like.
So what's your opinion on, like kind of like this contemporary style of Christian music where it's a, you know, it's not like a choir or anything, but people are making Christian music in different genres. What's your overall thought on that?
I mean, I think that any genre can be used to glorify Christ and what he's done. It doesn't necessarily have to be one thing or the other. The Bible says when it's talking about music that we use to worship God with, it says spiritual songs, hymns, or psalms. And so that kind of uses three words that cover pretty much anything. So, it's pretty much anything can be used.
All right. Well, today we're going to be looking at a band called The Wolves at the Gate from, I think I've showed you a couple songs of theirs before. I'm pretty sure they're Calvinists. At least from what I can tell from their lyrics.
I haven't listened to enough of their music. I'd be able to come to some sort of a conclusion if I listened to enough of the lyrics.
Okay. Well, this song is called Dead Man, so I say we get right into this.
I think I might have heard this before.
Okay, so right off screaming. There you go, your favorite. but right off the bat, what that song about there seems really cool. It seems like they have a solid understanding of the grace of the Lord, and like in the fact that he was saying like I stood opposed to God Himself, and yet He pardoned me. I want to look more into that later. What are your thoughts so far?
I thought that you would be opening up with the thoughts. No, it's very good. there's a lot of references to biblical passages. I mean, whenever he's speaking of I was a dead man, the Bible says you were dead in your trespasses and sins. I really like the lyrics when he says I didn't have a thought of peace, but only war. That is exactly how the Bible describes the unregenerate heart. We desire nothing but evil and to war against God and rebellion, and God has to change that about us in order for us to love Him, and that is ultimately how He gets all the glory in our salvation. So I very much like the theology that's being represented.
Awesome. Yeah, I agree. Like I said, what I look out for a lot in this style of music is... people like calling it Christian music but having like not very solid theology in what they're singing about, but from what I've deciphered from these guys so far, it seems like they're very theologically sound. So,
yeah, I think it's pretty cool.
Little break from the screaming for a second.
I've never known how I felt about it.
I think it's a pretty awesome song. I think it talks about the grace of God, you know, very well.
Mm-hmm.
But let's take a look at some of these lyrics and do a little bit of deciphering.
Okay.
Okay. Starting at the chorus, just that first line, where it talks about I was once a dead man. I think we can look to Ephesians 5.
Yeah.
I think that's where they're pulling that from. Because Ephesians 5 says, Ephesians 2, 5,
mm-hmm.
Sorry about that. It says, even when we are dead in our wrongdoings, he made us alive together with Christ. Talking about how we're dead in our sin, and then we can't have true life without Christ,
yeah.
Without being saved. I know you have some stuff to say about
mm-hmm.
this whole first part, so
yeah.
I'm going to let you talk.
Well, it's when he says, well, the very, very first verse, he says, I was once a dead man, like you said, clearly in allusion to Ephesians chapter 2. I like what Vodi Balcom has a bit to say about that when he says, but you were dead, and then he goes, I want to stop right there. And he says a lot of people like to change that to fit their own theological systems. Like maybe they were sick, maybe they were really, really sick.
Mm-hmm.
This, whoever wrote this, who's the lyricist of this? I'm not familiar with who that would be at Wolves of the Gate.
I'm not sure. I will do some research on that.
Okay.
I think the lead singer writes most of the music.
Mm-hmm.
But I will do some more looking.
It would make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he says, I was once a dead man, a stranger with no home. I stood opposed to God himself, and yet he pardoned me with all my heart and fiercest will, desire not but to thieve and kill. I hadn't a thought of peace but war. Surrender was not what I'd endure. And so he's clearly saying that is in his unregenerate heart, in his unregenerate state of being, he has absolutely no desire for God at all. And of course, the vast majority, I would say, of theologians out there, or basically Christians, anyone would have something to say on this topic, would have a completely different idea, that we were sick, but we had some sort of desire to do good. We don't make decisions in the context of our slavery to sin, but rather we make decisions in the context of absolute freedom, or a place, some sort of intermediate place where we can desire to do good things, we can also desire to do bad things. And if we want, we can choose God. If we don't want, we can't. Of course, I don't believe that's what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that we were actually dead in our trespasses, and it seems very clear to me that this man has the exact same idea. He says that with all my heart and fiercest will, I desired not but to thieve and kill. I think it takes a great level of maturity to really not trust your own experiences, because I think that in our past experiences it can kind of seem like we can want to do good. It seems like we are basically good people that simply make mistakes. If you ask the vast majority of people out there whether or not they think they're good people, oftentimes they'll say, yeah, I'm a good person, I just make some mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Christ says that if either you are with me or you are against me, and so anyone who does not fully love God and seek him and desire him is a rebel, and they hate God, and they will, and ultimately one of the main ways that we escape God is through religion. It's through creating our own moral systems. And when we create our own moral systems and then we follow those moral systems, it can very easily create the illusion that we are good people, because we create our own standards of morality and then we follow them. But that's really where evil comes from. The darkest part of Israel's history was Judges, and over again in Judges it says, in those days there was no king of Israel, everyone did what was right in their own eyes. The vast majority of evil is people doing what's right in their own eyes. It isn't people knowing that what they're doing is wrong and fully embracing and accepting that. Rather, it's them being the hero of their own story. And so this man, after coming to faith in Christ, realizes that his whole life beforehand was just an absolute hatred of God, and it took a miracle. It took a changing of his heart in order to rectify that.
Yeah. So I want to talk about this part where he's saying, deliver me, wake me up from this damning sleep. I'm surrendering, pull me out from this wickedness. Do you think he's talking about, like, conviction there? When he had the realization of, like, all of his sins were wrong.
Mm-hmm. So in the psalm where David is confessing his sin before God after the Bathsheba fiasco, he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, because he wants God to change his desires. He wants God to make him different. And I find myself, realizing my own sin, or after committing a certain sin, begging God to change those desires in me, because I want to live a life that pleases him. And ultimately, I think that that's the real difference between a regenerate person and someone who is unregenerate, is just the desire to follow God, and from that desire is going to come a prayers like this, where he says, deliver me, wake me up from this damning sleep. He wants to be different. He isn't yet, and so much of the Christian life is like that, where you have tendencies that you don't like, you have desires that you don't want to be in you, and it just causes you to want to cry out to God and ask him to change you. There is a book about that, by the way. I haven't read it, but I think it's I can't remember who wrote it, but I'll have to look it up.
Mm.
It's things like Lord Change Me or something like that.
Right. Yeah. I want to get your opinion on this part right here, where it says, you made a spectacle of rulers, denying you the king's fame. Having crushed the written canon that wrote of all our guilt and shame, displayed on a tree it was nailed, the saving power of your name. So that last part, displayed upon a tree it was nailed, the saving power of your name, is that talking about the crucifixion, do you think?
Yes, it is. It would be, I think the tree is a pretty clear reference.
Okay. But what about when it's talking, you made a spectacle of rulers denying you of a king's fame? What do you think they're saying there?
Not 100% certain.
Yeah.
It seems to me, when it says you made a spectacle of rulers denying you a king's fame, any king that desires to live and act or rule as if Christ is not the King of Kings would be a king that would want to deny Jesus of a king's fame. And when they say that you make a spectacle of those rulers, I'm not really exactly sure what they mean by that, but I do think that it could very easily just be something that the Bible teaches that Christ will reign until all his enemies are placed under his feet. And so not necessarily that he'll make a spectacle of all of them, but at the same time, there is some application where when these enemies are being placed under his feet, there is a spectacle being made of them. I mean, the Bible teaches about Pharaoh and how God created Pharaoh to show his power throughout all the earth. So, yeah, I think that could be what it's talking about. This isn't Bible, so it's not like... Yeah. This is just what one artist wants to say, so... I, of course, the only person who could ever have infallible knowledge about what it is that the artist is trying to say is the artist himself.
Right. I thought this part, this little line was cool too, where he says, "I'm surrendering this heart for which your blood it bought." Again, talking about Jesus just paying for our sins with his life. I mean, we can't really go too deep on that one, I don't think, but I just thought it was cool. Again, showing that they're actually... theologically sound. One more thing I want to point out, when they say you saw this wretch and you gave him life, again talking about how he you know, he was dead in his sin again, and he was unworthy of anything really. And yet God decided to show him grace and essentially like bury his old self and raise up a new person.
Yeah.
It's pretty much the idea there.
Yeah, and that's the picture that's being given to you by baptism.
Right. And then, of course, forever I'll praise you, I will praise you. That's just, again, you know, soli Deo Gloria.
This, well, yeah, this is pretty much the ultimate ending of all things. That's what heaven's going to be.
So, yeah. Glory to God alone.
Yeah.
All right, so... overall, what would you rate this song out of 10?
Out of 10?
Out of 10.
It isn't in my favorite genre, so I would not be the best at rating rock songs.
Yeah.
Because I don't indulge in that as much as you do.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the theology goes, it'd be like an 8 out of 10, 9, 10, yeah, 8 or 9. I would say 8 or 9.
I'd give it a 9 out of 10. So I'm taking you would recommend this song to... people who are looking for a good Christian rock to listen to.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd want to use this as worship technically.
Yeah.
It would seem a little difficult to use this for worship, especially in those settings. Not sure I'd want to use it for that. I mean, I guess it could be, because the object of worship is clearly God here. But yeah, it's if you want something good to listen to that is not heretical, that this would be a good option.
Yeah, I would also agree. I'd recommend Wolves at the Gate to anybody looking for some good Christian music. Heavy metal specifically. It's kind of a niche genre, I think, Christian heavy metal, but if you're looking for it, it's out there. There's good bands out there. All right, I think that's all we have for today. If you came by and watched this video, thank you. If you want to support, go ahead and subscribe and hit that like button. All right, God bless. Have a good day, everybody.